Welcome to part four of the fabulous estates of Santa Barbara and Montecito through vintage postcards and photographs. My name is George Sampanis, and I will be your host as we open a window into Santa Barbara's past. In part one, we looked at the very early estates of the 19th century. Then the incredible El Fioriti's estate with its reflecting pools descending some 70 feet. Riven Rock, the McCormick International Harvester family estate, and concluded with the Lotus Land and the unconventional Ganawalska. Part two encompassed Riso Rivo, the Eaton estate, the Mitchell's El Mirador, Pirenhurst, the Botheen Mansion and Tea Gardens, the Child Estate, the Murphy's El Tejado, and concluded with Las Tejas, the Thorn Estate. Part three highlighted the fabulous estates of the Four Horsemen or Hill Barons, the Peabody's, Knapp's, Billings, and Black's, their colorful and often opulent lives, and their philanthropic legacies to our community. Let us start part four with the Fleischmann Estate. Born in Dayton, Ohio in 1877, Max Charles Fleischmann was one of three children of Charles L. and Henriette. His father had emigrated from Austria, where he was an experienced yeast grower. He and his brothers started the Fleischmann Yeast Company, the first commercial yeast production firm in the United States. The company plodded along until they exhibited a model Vienna bakery in the Centennial Exhibition in Philadelphia, which gave the company national recognition and a significant increase in sales. A short time after the centennial ended, Vienna model bakeries and cafes were opened in Philadelphia, New York City, San Francisco, St. Louis, and Chicago. It is most likely this was America's first restaurant chain. When asked about his strength and muscular body, Max relayed this story. While in my early teens, my father gave me a tour of the yeast factory. When it was completed, he asked me what I found the most interesting. I told him that I had enjoyed seeing the big furnaces. For the next year, whenever I wasn't in school, I was put to work shoveling coal into those damn furnaces. At age 18, Max began working at the firm, learning the basics of the business, and attended Ohio Military Institute. He was an avid sportsman, outstanding polo and tennis player, a top amateur boxer, and played semi-professional baseball in Cincinnati. He joined the Army as second lieutenant when the Spanish-American War broke out, being promoted to first lieutenant. After the war, he returned to the firm, making an arrangement with his brother Julius to become president of the company, and Max, now 21, to be vice president and superintendent of the manufacturing department. This plan would allow Max more freedom to pursue his strong interest and desire to travel to primitive regions of the earth. Max was the complete sportsman, outdoorsman, and adventurer. In 1902, Max, his brother, and two others bought the Cincinnati Reds for $150,000. 3 years later, he married Sarah Hamilton Sherlock, a beautiful woman whose enthusiasm for travel, adventures, and outdoors matched his own. A few months after their marriage, they leased a ship and journeyed to the Arctic on a 3-month adventure. 7 months later, they were off to remote Africa for a big game hunt, where the party of 65 natives included 4 gun bearers, a cook, servants, and porters. Over the next 10 years, extended trips were made to the remote Alaskan Yukon, Ethiopia, Outer Mongolia, and Rhodesia. Max was fascinated by flight, being an aviator and a pioneer in hot air ballooning. In this 1907 New York Times article, he and a partner in the balloon's ownership are taking their first flight, ascending to 5,000 feet. 2 years later, he won an Aero Club-sponsored balloon race from St. Louis to the Atlantic coast. In between adventures, Max was a conscientious and capable businessman. He served on the board of several companies and as a director of a large bank. In 1911, Max and Sarah arrived in Santa Barbara by private rail car with a string of polo ponies for a competition at the Santa Barbara Polo Club. He said, "When I first beheld the beauty of the Carpinteria Valley, I knew I had at last found the home base I had been searching for." The Fleischmanns decided to establish a home here, but with World War I blazing in Europe, they delayed their plans. In 1916, Max had a narrow escape with death. While piloting his plane, with his wife Sarah looking on, he survived this crash while attempting to land. It was his first major mishap, sustaining 3 broken ribs. In 1917, with World War I in process, Max applied for and was appointed to the balloon section of the Army Air Corps. He was promoted to major and served as commandant of the Army Aeronautical Schools in Vadenay and Cuprelle, France. While overseas, he was put out of action by an enemy gas attack. Upon recovering from gas poisoning, he returned to the United States to become commandant of the United States Army Balloon School in Arcadia, California. After the war, he purchased 20 acres in Montecito, as well as 30 acres on Lambert Road in Carpinteria, where he built a surprisingly modest H-shaped villa that he named Edgewood for the stand of eucalyptus trees that bordered the property. The grounds included a 6-acre wild deer park, practice polo field, a shooting range, and an avocado and lemon orchard. In 1925, his brother Julius passed away, forcing Max to become head of the company. He did not want to leave Santa Barbara, so he sent for his brother's executive secretary to live at Edgewood. Then, in 1929, Fleischmann arranged a series of mergers with other firms to form Standard Brands, of which he became chairman of the board and the largest stockholder of the new firm. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, Fleischmann added 131 acres, built a conservatory that housed one of the largest organs ever made, added a 5-car garage and several cottages for employees. His trophy room is shown in this photo. Outside, the patio walls were adorned with exotic artifacts he had collected in his adventures. Not satisfied with his practice polo field, he purchased land near Serena and began construction of his own polo field. He added adjacent lots and built the polo field at the present location. That's Max on the white horse. By the 1930s, Santa Barbara now had four polo fields, thus laying claim to being the polo capital of the world. Pictured above is Fleischmann's 218-foot diesel cruiser, pronounced Haida. She was one of the 22 yachts owned by the major over the years. He also owned two airplanes at the same time. One, the Silver Falcon, is pictured below and taken at the Santa Barbara Airport. Without financial help from Fleischmann, Santa Barbarans today might still be arguing about creating a harbor. When Fleischmann came upon the scene, he was motivated to establish a harbor for at least two reasons. As an avid yachtsman, he saw the need for the economic vitality of the city, and secondly, it would provide a safe haven for his 218-foot Haida. He offered the city $200,000 if the city could raise another $200,000. Upon approval, he spearheaded a bond issue campaign. When the project cost exceeded budget, he funded the overrun. Later, when the beaches saw their sands disappearing because of lateral drift, Fleischmann again came through with $160,000 for dredging. The photo on the left from 1928 shows First Point, also known as Castle Rock, circled. The second, circa 1930, shows the breakwater at First Point and Second Point, now the beginning of Shoreline Park. In 1947, at age 71, Fleischmann's 22nd and last yacht, also named Haida, was built. She was 168 feet long and cost over $11 million in today's dollars. Everything that money could buy went into her construction, including two 1,000 horsepower diesels, automatic steering devices, radar, Loran, pathometers, and RDF or radio direction finders. She carried enough fuel, oil, and water to travel 6,000 miles with once having to touch port. She carried enough food to feed 10 officers and a crew of seven for months. The master bedrooms were soundproof. Mrs. Fleischmann's suite included a tiled bathroom with tub opening into her dressing room. Mr. Fleischmann's suite had a shower. The dining room was air-cooled and luxuriously carpeted. The walls were wood-paneled. The galley had a huge range with 12 burners. The salon was fitted with an electric fireplace and insulated to be comfortable in Arctic or tropical waters. The wheelhouse was fitted with state-of-the-art electronics. She carried two mahogany 140 horsepower launches, two rowboats, and a canoe. Fleischmann had a strong desire to start an agency which could fund worthy causes. In 1928, the major brought together 25 of Santa Barbara's leading citizens, including Chase, Stork, Hoffman, and Murphy, to create a new entity, the Santa Barbara Foundation. As seed money, he gave 3,400 shares of his company stock, valued at $50 million in current today's dollars. 2 years later, he deeded the Carrillo Hill adobe, which he had purchased in order to save it from demolition, to the foundation as its permanent headquarters and continued to provide funding over the years. The Santa Barbara Natural History Museum's Sarah Hamilton Fleischmann Bird Hall, laboratories, the auditorium, a new library, and the Hall of Mammals were all funded by the major. He served on the Board of Trustees for many years and was its president from 1934 to 1947. What follows is a partial list of other recipients of Fleischmann's generosity. St. Francis Hospital, Santa Barbara Boys Club, Boys Club of Goleta, Santa Barbara Commission on Alcoholism, the Young Men's Christian Association, Santa Barbara Trails, Botanic Gardens, Museum of Art, Music Academy of the West, Santa Barbara Symphony, Santa Barbara Girls Club, Camp Drake for Boy Scouts, Hillside House, American Women's Voluntary Services, Senior Citizen Center, Peabody Stadium Lights, and the St. Vincent School. Fleischmann sponsored several scientific publications and funded the restoration of the old mission after the 1925 earthquake. Major Max Fleischmann, the hunter, yachtsman, aviator, parachutist, balloonist, manufacturer, patriot, explorer, naturalist, conservationist, capitalist, investor, author, banker, consummate outdoorsman, and philanthropist, died in his home in Carpinteria on October 16, 1951. Sarah followed him in 1960. In his will, he gave his entire estate, excepting $1 million to the Fleischmann Foundation, which in turn funded a five-story surgical wing and cancer research at Cottage Hospital. He stipulated that the foundation would last 20 years past the death of Sarah, at which time all money must be spent. At that time, the assets had appreciated to $192 million, which was distributed to the benefit of the communities he had loved in California and Nevada. The assets of the Santa Barbara Foundation today have grown to be in excess of $320 million, being the largest grant maker in the county. Today, 13 acres of the original Edgewood Estate is the Lambert campus of Pacifica Graduate Institute for learning and research in the fields of psychology and mythological studies. Anna Dorinda Blakesley was born in St. Louis, Missouri in 1851. Upon her father's death, she and her sister Sarah inherited $500,000, which had been earned primarily in real estate development. Anna enjoyed the privileges of an upper-class lifestyle, having attended excellent schools both in the United States and abroad. Her eldest sister Sarah died unexpectedly just months after the birth of her second child. At age 27, Anna married Demas Barnes, a 51-year-old successful businessman whose investments in Fletcher's Castoria, a laxative for children, made him wealthy. Within a year, they had a daughter, Mildred Barnes, who was Anna's first and only child. Demas Barnes had another daughter, Cora, from a previous marriage. Cora was just 7 years younger than Anna and 26 years older than her half-sister, Mildred. They resided in New York City, where Demas died 10 years later, leaving an estate of $11 million to Anna, Cora, and Mildred. 5 years after Demas' death, Anna married William Henry Bliss, a widower, respected lawyer, and a former St. Louis district attorney. They lived in New York City and traveled extensively to Europe. In 1916, while visiting Santa Barbara, they purchased property on Hot Springs Road. Construction commenced on the Bliss Mansion in 1917, while they rented a nearby estate where they held several gala affairs, endearing themselves to the Santa Barbara social set. Their three-story Mission Revival-style mansion was completed in 1919. He was 75 and she was 66. When completed, the Carlton Winslow designed 48-acre Casa Dorinda estate had 80 rooms. Quoting Urban Hikers, the home, to just two elderly people, was staffed with 40 servants, including a valet, a footman, a secretary, a ground superintendent, a chef, cooks, maids, gardeners, security staff, a chauffeur, mechanics, and more. Some of the estate's noted rooms and amenities, the Oriental Room, the Long Hall, the Tower, the Grand Staircase, the Great Lawn, the Flower Room, the Napoleon Room, and the other favorite, the Corridor of Delight. These healthy-sounding places were in addition to the other grand rooms simply referred to as the music room, the dining room, the library, the elevators, and numerous guest bedrooms and sitting rooms. Urban Hikers continue. Aside from the rooms used by the Blisses and their frequent guests and visitors, the mansion had a variety of rooms in which the servants worked and lived. Unmarried servants lived inside the home, mainly on the second and third floors, while the married staff lived in outbuildings located on the estate. In addition to several garages, there was a two-story guest house on the property, as well as other outbuildings serving as caretaker lodge, firehouse, gatehouse, and other modern amenities. Casa Dorinda had its own generator, which could be used by the Blisses in the event of a loss of electricity. It also had its own water and pump house, which utilized much of the water that flowed in the creek running through the property. Lastly, Casa Dorinda had its own sewer system, which was quite innovative for the time. The sewer line reportedly ran from the house down Olive Mill Road, past the Biltmore, and into the ocean, end quote. Don't think the Biltmore guests were too happy about that. The home had imported marble fireplaces, Moorish hanging lamps, a sunroom with gold leaf walls, and carved ebony doors, pegged plank flooring, antique stained glass windows, and an organ loft. Mrs. Bliss loved to entertain. She hosted dinner parties, garden parties, music recitals, and other social events that were held with great regularity. This photo shows one such party on the Great Lawn, where dancers, magicians, and other entertainers amused the guests. When a dinner party was given, it was always a formal event. Following an elaborate dinner with elegant silverware, china, and crystal, we are told she personally counted the utensils and the glassware after the event. Another interesting story involved Ignacy Jan Paderewski, a world-renowned pianist and composer, and a former prime minister of Poland, who was to perform at one of her dinner parties. He arrived at the front entrance as Anna was checking off the names of the invited guests. She shooed him away, telling him to use the servants' entrance. He shrugged his shoulders philosophically and said, "It's all right. I'll just add another $5,000 to my bill." While the Blisses were on an extended trip to the Orient, King Albert and Queen Elizabeth of Belgium stayed at Casa Dorinda for 4 days. It was reported that 5,000 people showed up to greet the royal couple at the Santa Barbara train station when they arrived in town. Their agenda included swimming at Miramar Beach, taking tea at Mrs. Botine's Tea Garden, riding horses along the beach, taking a ride in the Lockheed Brothers airplane, driving up to Knapp's Castle, and attending Mass at the Old Mission. This bridge, the Corridor of Delight, connected Anna's bedroom suite with William's bedroom suite. The 1925 earthquake caused relatively little damage to the mansion. However, their marriage had turned very shaky. William, who was much more of a loner and introvert, reportedly grew weary of the noise and commotion that was ever present at the mansion. He moved into a modest home on Santa Barbara Street, never to return to Casa Dorinda. He died there in 1932 at age 88. In 1935, at age 84, Anna Dorinda Bliss passed on, leaving her estate valued at $12.4 million to her daughter Mildred. During World War II, Mildred offered Casa Dorinda to the United States Navy for use as a recuperation and recreation center. After the war, Dr. Homer F. Barnes purchased Casa Dorinda and opened the Montecito School for Girls, pictured in this postcard. It closed in 1956, and 14 years later, in 1970, it became an exclusive retirement residence. Anna had built a monument in the Woodlawn Cemetery, New York, dedicated to those who lost their lives in the sinking of the ocean liner Titanic in 1912. She is buried at the back of this monument. Anna Dorinda Bliss left her mark locally with several philanthropic gifts. In 1921, she gave $50,000 to the Cottage Hospital to build and equip two wings, one for the care of children and one for patients with contagious diseases. 5 years later, in 1926, she purchased 13 acres in Mission Canyon with views spanning from the mountains to the ocean, providing the foundation for the Blakesley Botanic Garden, named in honor of her father. It was renamed the Santa Barbara Botanic Garden in 1939. The Blakesley Library, which contains important botanical and horticultural works on California flora and landscape history, still carries his name. Hester Fisk, born in 1868, was the granddaughter of a Boston retail tycoon. At age 25, she married Gardner Green Hammond, Jr., a stockbroker. They lived in this house where they raised six children. The family visited Santa Barbara in 1908. 2 years later, the Hammonds separated, and Esther and her six children again headed west, arriving in Santa Barbara, this time with the expectation of creating permanent residency. Esther had tired of the harsh Boston winters and had health concerns for her firstborn, George, who had almost died of pneumonia. In the winter of 1910, Esther rented a beachfront estate built 4 years earlier by William Davidson. The family enjoyed the 8-acre Bonneymede estate so much that Esther bought the property 2 years later. Over the next 15 years, she bought additional property, expanding the estate to 46 acres and developed formal gardens. For fun and relaxation, another interesting feature was the enormous rope swings suspended from telephone poles. Quoting David Myrick, one of the delightful amenities of Bonneymede were the high swings on the edge of the bluff overlooking the surf. The taller swing had a double seat, and usually one of the boys, after pulling the swing up to the platform with a hook, would climb aboard with a guest and then swing clear to the islands, so it seemed. It took a long time for the swing to lose its momentum, so benches were placed on the platform for the next users, end quote. Two of Esther's children, George and Mary, are pictured about to enjoy a ride. The Hammond dog is unimpressed. Mrs. Hammond's net worth was hefty, but she wanted to instill in her children the importance of work and finances. She encouraged them and oversaw a number of family enterprises. They started the Bluebird Garage and Taxi Service. George ran the business and drove the taxi himself, while he and his brother were the auto mechanics. On part of the property, they established the Bluebird Ranch, where they raised vegetables, ran a dairy, and a poultry ranch. The estate had beautiful flower fields from which they sold flowers and donated the proceeds to charity. In addition to the giant swing, there was a bowling alley, several workshops, and a bathhouse. Having taken lessons from Earl Ovington, who has been mentioned in several prior presentations, George Hammond became an accomplished aviator and built two grass-covered airstrips at Bonneymede. The strips were also used as a nine-hole golf course and as a polo field. Hammond made more than 200 flights to deliver mail and other supplies to the Lester family of San Miguel Island. The book, The Legendary King of San Miguel, chronicled the life of the king, Herbert Lester, and his family. Hammond and his airplane are pictured on the island beach. Pictured bottom right is George delivering mail to Lester. Esther Hammond remained active into her mid-70s, still enjoying ocean swims. She died at the age of 87 in 1955. Her son George continued to live on a part of the family property until his death at 85 in 1982. In 1958, part of the estate was sold to a syndicate of developers that tore down the house. 8 years later, in 1966, the western part of the estate became the site of two large luxury condominium complexes, Bonneymede and Montecito Shores. The eastern part of the estate, known as Hammond's Meadow, became the scene of contentious controversy when it was discovered to have once been the burial site of a large Chumash community and burial ground called Shalawa. This drawing from Roger's book, Prehistoric Man of the Santa Barbara Coast, provides the location of the native community he uncovered in 1924. Having excavated a mitten mound, he set upon searching for the burial grounds, which he discovered in the area I have circled. As a totally unrelated subject, his map displays the area the rancheros held the historic matanza, or cattle slaughter, during the drought of the 1860s. Herds were reduced from 200,000 to less than 5,000. As many died of starvation. As many as 100,000 were slaughtered here. Their hides were salted and dried, The carcasses were boiled in great cauldrons to recover the tallow, which, along with the horns, was sold. Back to the subject. The Chumash, joined by surfers and some area residents, began a movement to protect the meadow site. In 1989, a sort of compromise was reached as 20 condos and 12 private homes were built. They are pictured both left and right of the 3-acre cleared meadow, which was set aside and preserved for public use. Today, some controversy continues regarding the maintenance and the use of the meadow, but a monument pictured in these three photos has been placed in the meadow. It displays inlaid tiles with lizards, birds, flowers, and two dolphins with an inscription dedicated to the spirit and memory of Chumash ancestors. In 1925, Charles H. Luddington, an executive of Curtis Publishing Company in Philadelphia, came to Santa Barbara with his two sons. Luddington was somewhat familiar with the area as his son Wright had attended the highly selective Thacker School in Ojai. Charles purchased a large Mediterranean home in Sycamore Canyon and immediately set upon making considerable alterations. The original home, Dias Felices, or Happy Day, had been designed by Bertrand Goodhue 10 years earlier. Charles hired Lockwood DeForest, a former Thatcher schoolmate of his son, to alter and improve the landscaping of the estate. In 1927, Charles died and his son Wright inherited the estate. He renamed it Val Verde, meaning Green Valley. Over the next 30 years, the landscape underwent a major transformation under Wright Luddington's ownership and Lockwood DeForest's design. The black and white photographs in this section reflect how the changes to the house and the gardens blended in a harmony encompassing both. New fountains, terraces, reflecting pools, a swimming pool, and trees were added. Additional structures and modifications to the main house were carried out with DeForest's approval. A large atrium was erected where guests gathered and enjoyed Wright's garden parties. Also added was an art gallery, which displayed some of Wright's collection of paintings and statuary. There were three series of 12-foot-high columns around the property. One of the three is shown in this photograph. Wright employed 14 skilled gardeners to maintain the Val Verde Gardens, shown on the next 12 slides. Thank you. peek inside, a friend, Mr. Baxter, wrote this description of his accommodations in the Val Verde mansion. Quote, I had known Wright Luddington all my life, and his house in Santa Barbara remained the one thing in America I wanted to see and had not. So I was doubly delighted when he called to ask me to come out for a visit, said Baldwin. Come, he said, I'll show you to your room. He opened the door, not to a guest room, but to an art gallery. We entered at one corner and looked down what seemed to be an endlessly long room, at least 60 feet. The white walls were filled with a fantastic collection of paintings of every period and nation. I stopped at every picture. Suddenly, it occurred to me that there weren't any windows, yet the room was filled with light. I looked up to see an ingenious skylight that extended the room's entire length. No one has ever awakened to such a glorious sunlight. At each end of the room was a four-poster bed with blue and white curtains. He continues, each bed had its own table, chest of drawers, books, and a good light for reading. The beds were so remote from one another, and the curtains pulled so cozily around them that even if you had to share the room, it would be like having the place all to yourself. Beside my bed was the bath and dressing room, painted brilliant yellow, with an enormous window directly over the tub. From that window, I could look down the tawny grass valley to the blue Pacific far below, end quote. Luddington was a founder of the Santa Barbara Museum of Art and one of the museum's major donors, having given over 175 pieces of his world-class art. Part of his classic Greek statuary collection is on display in the Luddington Court, named in his honor. In 1955, Luddington sold Val Verde to Dr. and Mrs. Warren Austin. The doctor had once been a physician to the Duke and Duchess of Windsor in the Bahamas. Mrs. Austin had inherited millions from her father, who was the founder of the Chicago Bridge and Iron Company. The Austins were patrons of local theater and opera, providing generous financial support. They made no major changes to the residence and kept the fabulous gardens intact while adding 8 acres to the grounds. Mrs. Austin died in 1991, and Val Verde passed solely to Dr. Austin, who from the beginning had intended to open Val Verde to the public. In 1996, he applied for the necessary conditional use permit that would allow 3,340 visitors a year and a steady income stream. He established the Austin Val Verde Foundation as a charitable trust to fund Val Verde's preservation. In July 1999, the American Society of Landscape Architects honored Dr. Austin with the Medallion Award for his 50-year stewardship of one of America's most beloved landscapes. The next day, the Santa Barbara County Supervisors voted on an appeal from neighbors to deny land use permits that would have guaranteed Val Verde's preservation and its endowment. Dr. Austin died that year, and for several years, following legal proceedings, appeal after appeal ended with the denial of the permit and the foundation's $7 million funds depleted. In 2006, the foundation borrowed $13 million using the estate as collateral, which was against the late Austin's wishes. In 2009, the foundation, having fallen behind on $1.4 million in loan payments, filed for bankruptcy. Then, in 2010, what followed were charges by Dr. Austin's niece that the foundation's executive director had, quoting the Santa Barbara Independent, squandered funds and spent money in questionable ways. The niece asked the Santa Barbara County and California Attorneys General to investigate. The Val Verde problems continued. Quoting Barney Branningham, billionaire banker Sergei Grishin, who lives near the property, bought it out of bankruptcy last year for $15.3 million, then sold it a few months ago to another neighbor, Peter Mueller, for $14.8 million, apparently with somewhat less land. Bankruptcy trustees have sued Grisham in bankruptcy court for allegedly reneging on an agreement to pay an additional $450,000 for the estate's furnishings. The items were eventually auctioned off for around $200,000, end quote. We close this episode of the fabulous estates of Santa Barbara and Montecito with the Austin Val Verde Foundation defunct and the Val Verde estate now in private ownership.